You probably maybe saw the news that recently that the Trump administration has scaled back refugee admissions for the coming year to 30,000, and justifying the move in part by saying they needed resources to work through a backlog of over 800,000 pending asylum applications. The news was met by the predictable wailing and gnashing of teeth by the media and the refugee resettlement industry, which has siphoned off billions of dollars over the years, a big chunk of which has gone to fund their generous salaries, perks, and lavish lifestyles. We're so fortunate to have our next speaker back with us today because she's been here, I think it was like 3 or 4 years ago that Ann was here. She's probably the foremost non-governmental expert on U.S. refugee programs in the nation. Ann Corcoran is the founder of Refugee Resettlement Watch, and she has been a one-woman wrecking machine for many of the resettlement industry's pet schemes. Ann, thank you so much for coming back to be with us today. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having me. Can you all hear me? I hope you're not going to fall asleep with my talk this afternoon. It's really horrible to come right after lunch, and especially after Candace Owen this morning. So bear with me. I am not a speaker. I'm a blogger, and so I have to use notes. So here we go. My title of my talk is Refugee Resettlement in the Age of Trump and Beyond. My subtitle should be Go on the Offense, and I want you to consider that as I go through this. It's nice to be back. What a difference a couple years makes, right? I was here last in, I think it was 2015, and not in my wildest dreams did I think that I would see the U.S. Refugee Admissions Program on the ropes only a few years later. As you know, and as we just heard, there's good news about that the Trump administration is doing to get our refugee program under control. But I'm going to argue that, as we learned with President Obama, executive orders are short-term fixes. And if the refugee program is not reformed by law while Trump is in the Oval Office, there will be no permanent change. No permanent change. Indeed, a new president, either a Democrat or any Republican we could envision right now, would simply say, we're going to boost numbers to make up for the Trump lost years. That's what they'll call it, the Trump lost years. It'll be full steam ahead in 2021 or 2025. So I'm going to tell you what's happening for the first portion of my time here, but then I want to hear from you about what you think needs to be done to permanently reform the program. Pretend that someone from the White House calls you and wants to know what you think about the refugee admissions to the United States. That will be the beyond portion of my talk. Now, I don't want this to be a 45-minute lecture with mind-numbing data. However, I have provided some mind-numbing data sheets I'll be referring to from time to time, and I'd like you to look in your packet. You'll see them, and there was an additional one added this morning. So I'll refer to those, but really they're meant for you to take home for your leisure time reading. Maybe take a few notes as I talk and I explain the process and see if you can't come up with some reform ideas. If there is ever going to be reform of the program, permanent reform, the people in this room must lead it. I've been here before, so many of you know me and know the basic topic of my talk, the U.S. Refugee Admissions Program. But just in case there are some audience members who find this new, I'll start with a few necessary bits of information, including how I got into this in the first place. For the last nearly 40 years, I've considered myself a farmer, although I have a master's degree in forestry and wildlife, and I won't say from where in light of this morning's discussions. My interests are really outdoors, and I want to be there every day. But all that changed in 2007. By the way, in the bio packet, my bio doesn't mention my distinction from the Southern Poverty Law Center. I was chosen a few years ago as one of the top 15 anti-Muslim extremists in America. And personally, I thought it was a huge joke, considering that I am just a single blogger at home with my cat. I mean, that's the extent of my hate group. So in 2007, in the county where I live in Western Maryland, a red county, refugees began to arrive thanks to a church group, the Virginia Council of Churches. They were mostly Meshkedian Turks who had been living in Russia. Russia didn't like them, and Turkey didn't want them back, and so the U.S. said, sure, send over about 20,000, which is what we ultimately took. They were not refugees living in camps, and many had homes to sell. A few hundred of those came to Washington County, Maryland, and me and several other neighbor ladies just wanted to know, how could this happen? Who said a Virginia church group could make our county a resettlement site when none of us had ever heard about it? Long story short, I couldn't get our local newspaper to explain this news and give us the basic information about who approved the resettlement and who was paying for it all. Someone suggested I write a blog to explain how the program works. Well, here I am, over 11 years later. Maybe I am the definition of insanity. I plug away at this subject every day on my own. I don't work for anyone, and sometimes feel like quitting, which will be very likely if the refugee program is not reformed during Trump's time in office. The Refugee Act of 1980 started it all. Ted Kennedy, Joe Biden, and Jimmy Carter are the major culprits. They set up what I see as a horribly flawed system in how we admit refugees. Prior to 1980, refugees were taken care of privately through churches and other civic groups. But the Refugee Act set up a system where federal contractors are paid by the head to place refugees in towns and cities without any discussion or debate. In fact, most people don't even know about it until, like us in Washington County, a few problems cropped up and citizens wanted answers. If we're going to bring refugees to America, one of the primary reforms I want to see is the secrecy removed from the decision-making process. Frankly, the deplorables, as Hillary called them, including me and my fellow local citizens, have every right to know what Washington, D.C. is planning for us. Here in a nutshell is what I've learned as I began posting almost those 11 years ago now. The UN selects most of our refugees from their camps around the world. We may have no national interest in a particular ethnic group. For instance, the Bhutanese, Bush told the UN that we would take 60,000 over 5 years. We're now approaching 100,000. We're not responsible for squabbling between Bhutan and Nepal. We never sent any military there to disrupt their countries. Likewise, the Obama administration promised the UN we would take 50,000 from the DR Congo over 5 years, starting in 2014. And we're almost there now and still going strong with over 46,000 arrivals to date. Today, when you hear even the Heritage Foundation talk about foreign policy objectives with refugee resettlement, that's the kind of thing they're talking about, that refugees are used as chits and pawns for obtaining some other foreign policy objective is flat out wrong. They're either legitimate refugees or they are not. Local citizens should not have to carry the financial and social burden for the sake of our relationships with other countries and with the United Nations. Meshkedians, the Bhutanese, the DR Congolese, and the Uzbeks are not our problems. Of course, some argue that we broke Iraq and Afghanistan, so they're always saying that those are our problem. Let me tell you about the Australia deal. Do you know about the Australia deal?
Yes.
Huh? The Australia dumb deal, as Trump called it. So 5 years ago or so, the Australian government said rightly that anyone trying to reach Australia by boat would not be allowed to ever access the Australian mainland. It's too bad Europe didn't have the guts to say the same thing at the same time. Australia's illegal alien boat people were put in detention on offshore islands. You may know that Obama consummated a deal with Australia in the waning months of his administration where we would take off their hands and transform those failed asylum seekers to legitimate refugees to live in your towns. In Obama's deal, We would take 1,250 of them to the U.S. as refugees. Trump, after first complaining to the Australian Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull that it was a dumb deal, agreed to vet them for admission to the U.S. We're at 316 so far. Imagine this. Young men held in all-male detention from places like Pakistan for up to 5 years are now free in America, somewhere in America. So the next time you hear that we need to bring refugees for foreign policy reasons, remember that Americans living in small to medium-sized cities who have no say in who their new neighbors will be, plucked from somewhere else in the world. When they do find out about them and complain, they're immediately called racist, xenophobes, and Islamophobes, if that fits. Now, Homeland Security is screening our refugees more thoroughly. That's something that Trump put into place. We're not even going to go into the whole security screening thing, because that'd be a whole hour. But here's what happens next. The U.S. State Department contracts with nonprofit groups to place them in your communities. Now, I want you to just take a quick look at one of the handouts. It's called the 9 Federally Funded Refugee Resettlement Agencies. It's in your packet. And you'll see the 9 major federal contractors, which include the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, Lutheran Immigration Refugee Service, and so on and so forth. The numbers in parentheses, the first parenthesis is my analysis 2 years ago of the percentage of federal funding. So take Church World Service, 71% federally funded 2 years ago. And then more recently, the Center for Immigration Studies did a new study, and they say they're 73% funded by us, the taxpayers. So what the State Department does then is they work secretly with those contractors, with those 9 that are paid with our tax dollars. They divvy up the cases that come in each week, and they distribute them around the country. There's about 170 cities and towns they distribute them to. The people in those cities and towns do not know they are coming. Well, actually, some people do with the interfaith groups, but that's another story. For me, this is one of the aspects that keeps me going, because I saw it where I live. We had no advance warning that Hagerstown, Maryland had been chosen. Now, I also want you to go to the map. You'll have a map in your packets that looks like this. And this shows, since Trump took office on January 1st, 2017, to up to the 1st of September this month, we've resettled 43,598 refugees, and this is where they went. I know it's real hard to see the numbers on the map. This is from the State Department, by the way, the map. But on the back, it has a list of all of the states and how many refugees went to each state. But you can look at that more carefully when you have a chance at home. So those 9 contractors are almost completely funded with taxpayer dollars. Let me repeat. Those 9 contractors are almost completely funded with taxpayer dollars. Jim Simpson, you have another handout in here. Jim Simpson prepared just recently for the Capital Research Center a chart showing since 2008 the amount, the millions of dollars that have gone to each of the contractors, and then you'll see the unaccompanied alien children finances are in 3 columns there too. That's how much the federal government is paying for the unaccompanied alien children. But you'll see, for example, the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops since 2008 got $742 million from us. So the contractor's job is to find the refugees' work, set them up with housing, food stamps, medical care, et cetera. Then in 3 to 6 months, sometimes sooner, they go on to a new set of paying clients. But here's the rub. And the major reason refugee admissions should not be done by nonprofit contractors. First, there's no incentive to slow the flow when they're paid by the head. And then those same contractors become well-funded community organizers and political agitators. I am saying that this program will never be reformed as long as those 9 federal contractors, 6 of them are religious groups, are leading the effort. They're freaking out right now, though, because as Trump's numbers drop, so too does their money. So Trump has dramatically reduced the number entering the United States. The cap for fiscal year 18 was 45,000, but the number of actual admissions was in the 20,000s. So, and the, oh, and let me just mention, the Muslim percentage of refugees has dropped significantly since the ban blocked many. However, there are still significant numbers of special immigrant visa holders from Afghanistan arriving. We have brought 60,000 Afghans to the United States who supposedly have helped us in the last 5 years. 60,000. Now, the top countries this year are the DR Congo, Burma, Ukraine, Bhutan. Oh, and I should say on Burma, a significant number of the Burmese coming in now. They used to be Christians and other minorities, but a significant number are now Rohingya Muslims coming in from Burma. Bhutan, Eritrea, El Salvador. We brought 672 refugees from El Salvador. They're not refugees in El Salvador. And the Somalis, though, happily are down to 250 for this year. So here we are on September 30th, the last day of fiscal year 18. I assume all of you have been following the news that Trump's announced determination to set a ceiling for refugee admissions for the coming year at 30,000. That's the lowest ceiling ever. However, the numbers entering the United States with some claim to refugee status are much greater than that. I want you to see all the categories of legal immigration where most are considered refugees of one form or another. That's this chart Simpson prepared for the Capital Research Center. It says Refugee Resettlement Program numbers. And you'll see the column for refugees, the huge number we brought in refugees, what the ceiling was, the special immigrant visas, total is 70,000 over since 2008. That would be the Iraqis and the Afghans. Now, asylees, you'll see, asylees are, someone asked me earlier to define the difference between refugee and asylum seeker slash asylee. Refugees are the people we pick from abroad, which, that we're involving this cap that Donald Trump just said at 30,000. We pick them from abroad. Well, the UN picks them mostly from abroad. Asylum seekers are people who've gotten across our border through various means and then ask for asylum. They're asking for refugee status in the United States. And that's where you're seeing all this news now. The Trump administration is saying we have this huge backlog of asylum seekers that we have to process through the courts, and that's what they're working on. But you can see, we brought 266,000 granted asylum to 200. Oh yeah, it's oh yes. Yeah. Sorry, there were several pages that I added two more pages this morning. Sorry about that. So yes, it's Refugee Resettlement Program numbers. But you can look at those when you should have a separate page that came loose. Sorry, I'm losing you. It was a separate piece of paper. No, it's a separate piece. Sorry. Some of you have it there. You can really look at these later more carefully. But Refugee Resettlement Program numbers. Simpson did this for the Capital. You probably all know Jim Simpson for the Capital Research Center. The total since 2008 is nearly 1.7 million people who are treated as some form of refugee. Each year, the president, this is where we are right now, usually in September, sends a report with a determination to Congress for consultation. He says how many we could bring in and where he wants us to direct our attention. It is a cap. It is a cap. It is a cap. It is not a target to be reached, although the open borders left wants you to think that what the number the president sets every year, they want you to think it is a target to be achieved. It is not. It is a cap. He can stay anywhere under that without further consultation with Congress. In fact, there is nothing in refugee law that says we have to take any at all. So we have, let's see, I want to direct you to another chart in your packet. Again, you can look at it later. One of them, it's from the Department of State. It tells the ceiling, the numbers, and you'll see. Have you heard on the news all this stuff about Obama brought 110,000? He didn't bring 110,000. He never brought 110,000. He had some years that were in the 50,000s, but we're told constantly by the media that he had 110,000. But I do want to direct your attention to the little arrow that I put here. You'll see in September 2 years ago, 12,000 refugees came in 1 month of September 2 years ago. This year, September, it's going to, when Annette wraps up tomorrow, it's going to be about 3,000. And I need to move along here so I can get done. So another chart, look at, when I was doing my numbers, we aren't going to save Africa. by the way. It has a huge population explosion. That's an understatement. And we're not going to save Africa. But when I was doing my numbers research, and you'll have to look at that document yourself, I noticed that Trump dramatically reduced the African numbers. So from Obama brought 31,000 Africans 2 years ago. You'll see all of those listed, the countries listed. And Trump this year, as of September 1st, brought 9,000. So it's way down. However, Trump is now prioritizing Africans, and the ceiling for Africa is way above the other regions of the world for this next year, and he wants to bring 11,000 additional Africans. So, and needless to say, and we're not going to have much time to talk about it, but you can see in the handouts I have, this program is enormously expensive. And when you look at the, you can't even figure how much per person. It's just impossible, because here's what you can't figure. You've got $1 billion a year just to bring them into the country, okay, the refugees into the country. You've got the Trump administration put out a report that the program has cost $125 billion over 10 years, and that doesn't include most of the welfare. It doesn't include the education of the kids. It doesn't include interpreters. You may know that the Clinton administration requires interpreters for just about anything, or the Clinton administration did an executive order that requires expensive interpreters. This is one of the expenses at the local level. It doesn't include the criminal justice system, and it doesn't include my favorite, which is remittances, which is the amount, the millions sent out of our economy every year back to the home country that's lost to the U.S. economy. So let me recap the big problems. UN picks our refugees, major problem. We've expanded the definition of what is a refugee. There's an enormous cost to taxpayers. There's a security threat. The push for cheap labor, this is one of the parts that really annoys me, is hidden from the public. We're made to believe this is a humanitarian program. It is, some call it kind of slave labor, because we're bringing in refugees to work at these god-awful meatpacking plants for cheap wages. The numbers are huge. As I said, refugees, asylees, Cuban, Haitians, special immigrant visa holders, temporary protected status, and the list goes on. The secrecy, which is keeping the target resettlement communities in the dark, is wrong. The costs are being shifted to the states. And then the contractors act as political advocacy groups for all kinds of immigration, not just for the more legal immigration. They are advocating for the DACA kids. They supported the Gang of Eight bill a few years ago. These nine contractors that we're paying are also acting as community organizers and political organizers. So,
they're on our salary.
It should infuriate you. We pay them to work against us. Anyway, beyond Trump, although it's great that the president has drastically lowered the number of refugees to be admitted, it's not enough. The House and Senate Judiciary Committees are not seriously interested in reform. There's too much influence, I believe, on the Republicans from big business, the meat packers, and the Chamber of Commerce types. In 2016, I traveled around the country, got in my car, traveled to a lot of meatpacking towns out west, to meet people who were impacted by this influx of refugee labor to the meatpacking plants. It was really pretty much an eye-opener. So I contend that the only way to force a review is for Trump. This is the key for me. We have to go on the offense. I contend that the only way to force a review is for Trump to set the number, the ceiling, at zero, and then tell Congress it's time for a debate. That's the only hammer we have. Set the number at zero, call for a moratorium, and then have a debate. Because the Republicans in Congress will move then, because they do want some of this cheap labor, and maybe we'll have this discussion in public. So, do we dump the original law and start again, fix this one, or do we want no refugee program at all? I don't believe it can be fixed as long as those nine federal contractors are given the job of placing refugees on a per-head basis, and then they community organize and lobby for more refugees and more immigration of all sorts, since they do not just advocate for legal immigration, but are busy with DACA and the border wall as well. So, frankly, we have to stop discussing these topics and going away and saying, ain't it awful? And then taking no aggressive initiatives to change anything. If there is going to be reform, it must come from this room. Surely we aren't waiting for the Republicans to lead, are we? So let me take some questions, and I would want to hear about the fix, what you think the fix should be. Pretend that the White House has just called you in for your ideas. Pretend Stephen Miller called you up and said, all right, we're going to fix this. What do you think should be done? And so, and let me just emphasize with, let's just go on the offensive for a change and stop being defensive about this issue.
So the question is, or my if I got the call, I would say maybe two things. One is that to require that whatever cap is set every year, that Congress would have to vote to approve that, as well as the full funding that supports it, including the education costs and the other costs that are associated with the refugees. The second thing would be for the State Department to contract directly with a local government entity that would have to approve, you know, a city or a county or whatever, would have to approve that contract to resettle so many refugees in their community before it could go ahead. I'd like to have your comments on those. That
proposal. Well, I wasn't planning to comment. I was going to write down everybody's ideas.
Oh, okay.
So let's recap. You think that Congress should approve what number the would have approval would veto power over the president? Is that what you're saying? Or
yeah, that Congress every year, whatever the cap was set at, would have to approve that. Would have to have a congressional vote in both houses of Congress to approve it, as well as the full associated funding to require this, that would be required to support that number.
Okay.
And then the local government entities would have to contract directly with the State Department and approve any resettlement within their communities.
Okay, so you're saying that the federal government should follow up with funding for the interpreters, for the criminal justice system, when a refugee commits a murder and goes through the court system, the feds are going to pay the local jurisdiction that has to run through the court system.
Yeah, it might not be possible to get things like the criminal justice system, but certainly the education costs, certainly all the, you know, the refugees are the gold standard for welfare benefits in this country. They're entitled to instantly when they arrive in this country, they're entitled to every potential federal and local state welfare benefit, cash assistance, you know, whatever that there is. So it would be the full cost of resettling every single refugee, as well as the number, and then have to have it approved by the local government entity. You know, if they were going to resettle, you know, another 100 refugees in Hagerstown, the Hagerstown City Council or the government or the county government would have to approve that and contract directly.
It's an interesting idea. I'm just going to write down the ideas. Back here, this lady. Thanks. For those of you who don't know, the asylum seekers coming across our border, a lot of them were claiming that their husband was beating them, and so therefore they were entitled to refugee status in the United States. And I'm making light of it, but there has been this huge expansion under Obama and previous to what is the definition of a asylum seeker or refugee. No. As a matter of fact, you can look for it online. There's a report that the Trump administration just put out. It's proposed refugee admissions for fiscal year 2019. It kind of looks like this. Actually, I've written about it on my blog, so you can search for it. There's a description in there of the refugees who are going to be coming and stuff. There is no mention. I looked. It's one of the first things I look for. Unless somebody's seen it that I haven't seen, because I haven't read every single word, I don't see anything about the South African white farmers. But I do need to tell you all that we are taking black refugees from South Africa. At this point, it's a completely illegal. This is another thing that just makes me mad. It's completely illegal. Let me just take a step back. When illegal migrants, illegal aliens, arrive in Malta, for example, take Malta, and boat people, We have been taking, since the Bush administration, hundreds of those illegal aliens from Malta as refugees to the United States. They are transformed, mostly Somalis and other Africans are transformed. This is one of the things that Congress could fix very easily. They could just disallow this. We're doing the same thing from South Africa. The South African government does not want, or the people of South Africa, I should say, not necessarily the government, the people do not want the Somalis, the Sudanese, the Ethiopians coming down and coming into their country. So we are actually taking South African blacks, well, not South Africans themselves, other Africans that the South Africans do not want in their country. And we take about 500 or 600 of those a year off their hands from South Africa. No, I was curious about that this year because there was a pressure. There was some pressure on Trump to bring in some of the white South African farmers, and it's not mentioned in here. Now, that's not to say that we wouldn't, but it's not mentioned. So I can tell. Let's over here. Yeah, and I absolutely agree with you, and you all have been doing great at that educational argument. I'd like to see everybody making that educational argument, and the question I want to ask is, okay, well, how many more years do we have to educate people? I mean, is there a limit to how many people we're reaching? I would like to see, frankly, more grassroots interest where the folks who really know this information are going out and meeting with people in communities so that the pressure comes from within the community to change things. Maybe pick the 170 sites where we're placing refugees right now and start to educate those communities so that their local people can get involved politically and push that upward. Because I'm seeing, maybe it's just my age, I'm just seeing the end is near and Trump won't be there much longer. And we have to move more quickly, I guess, is where my thinking is. The shutdown, the revolving door between the VOLAGs and the resettlement agencies the HHS and the State Department, they go back and forth. They're so frustrating and it's maddening. Take Ann Richard, who had been at the, first she was at the International Rescue Committee as a vice president. Then she went in and she became the Assistant Secretary of State for Population, Refugees, and Migration. Now, there's another one. Lavinia Limon was a contractor. She went in and headed the Office of Refugee Resettlement for a number of years under Clinton. Then she came out and she's the head of it. Well, she was fired recently for something shady, we don't know. But then she came out and headed one of these contractor groups. They go back and forth. That's got to be stopped. That's something that could be fixed. There's all sorts of little fixes like this that could be done without some big sweeping change. Just start nipping away at these little things. Disallow that. I've had so many hands up. As a matter of fact, let me say on that, don't we have enough smart people at the State Department to decide which refugees are worthy of coming into America without having to take all of these people that the issue of the Bhutanese, the 100,000, it's just mind-boggling that we would clean out a UN camp when the rest of the world was supposed to participate in that, and the rest of the world hardly took any, and we took almost all of them. Anyway, sorry. Yeah, don't you wish the ACLU would jump in on this? Yeah, where are they? Where are they? This is the kind of stuff that's been going on for 30 years with it, more than 30 years with this program. It's just that people didn't know about it. They just assumed their local Catholic Charities was doing this out of the goodness of their heart and did not know they were being paid to do this job. And it isn't just the per head payment. It also involves extra grants that they get for some of the weirdest things, like grants for how to have a healthy marriage. Believe it or not, I'm going to wrap up with this. The Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society was getting $100,000 a year grants to teach refugees how to have a healthy marriage. And my big joke was, so the Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society was teaching the Muslim refugees how to have healthy marriages? I mean, on our dime? I mean, really? I'm sorry. I guess I'm over my time here.
Thank you so much, Anne.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.